Hello student. In the previous video, we have seen decomposition, processes and mapping, as well as we discuss about the task interaction graph and task dependency graph. Now, in this video or in the current article, we will see decomposition techniques. Basically, why this decomposition is required, that you know. After decomposition, we get different subtasks. So as mentioned earlier, one of the fundamental steps that we need to undertake to solve a problem in parallel is to split the computation to be performed into set of tasks for concurrent execution defined by task dependency graph. In this section, we describe some commonly used decomposition technique for achieving concurrency. This is not an exhaustive set of possible decomposition techniques. Also, a given decomposition is not always guaranteed to lead to the best parallel algorithm for given problem. Despite these shortcomings, the decomposition technique described in this section often provide a good starting point for many problems, and one or combination of this technique can be used to obtain effective decomposition for large variety of problems. The techniques are broadly classified as recursive decomposition, data decomposition, exploratory decomposition, and speculative decomposition. Now here it is a data decomposition. Recursive decomposition is written twice, but one of them is data decomposition. So recursive decomposition is the first technique, then data decomposition is the second technique, exploratory decomposition is the third, and speculative decomposition is the fourth technique. Also, there is a hybrid decomposition is also shown there. The recursive and data decomposition techniques are relatively general purpose as they can be used to decompose a wide variety of problems. On the other hand, speculative and exploratory decomposition techniques are more of the special purpose nature because they apply to specific class of problems. Okay, now we will start our first decomposition technique, that is data decomposition. What is the data decomposition? Data decomposition is a powerful and commonly used method for deriving concurrency in algorithms that operate on large data structure. In this method, the decomposition of computation is done in two steps. The first step, the data on which the computation are performed is partitioned. And in the second step, this data partitioning is used to induce a partitioning of computation into tasks. Okay, so a data decomposition can be carried out into two steps. First step, the partitioning is done. The data on which the computation are performed is partitioned. And in the second step, data partitioning is used to induce partitioning on computation into tasks. The operation that this task perform on different data partitions are usually similar. For example, matrix multiplication introduce or chosen from a small set of operation. Okay, so partitioning and data partitioning is the first step, and in second step, this data partitioning is used to induce a partitioning of computation into tasks. So that is the two step in a data decomposition. The partitioning of data can be performed in many possible ways as discussed next. In general, one must explore and evaluate all possible ways of partitioning the data and determine which one yield a natural and efficient computation composition. Now, how to partitioning the data? Now, partitioning the data, again, there are three types, because data may be the input data, data may be the output data, and data may be the intermediate data. So we need to identify the data on which we want to perform the computation. As I said, the data may be the input data. Data may be the output data, or data may be the intermediate data. So that is our first job, to identify the data on which the computations are performed, partitioning that data across various tasks. Once we identified, suppose the you identify the output data, then that data is partitioned across various tasks. This partitioning induces a decomposition of the problem. Data can be partitioned in various ways. This is critically impact the performance of parallel algorithm. Now suppose we will select the output data decomposition. So suppose your data is output data. Okay. Now we need to decompose that output data. Okay. So suppose I will give you the example, A plus B is equal to C. So what is the output data here? C is the output data. And now we select that C as output data for decomposition. Okay. So that is a clear idea in output data decomposition. Whereas we focus on input data. So A plus B. So A plus B are the input data. A and B are the input data that we again select for decomposition in case of input data decomposition. But right now we will focus on output data decomposition. So often, each element of output can be computed independently of other, but simply as a function of input. A partition of output across the task decomposes the problem naturally. Now, a good example is the matrix multiplication. Now, here that example is shown. Consider the problem of multiplying two n by n matrices A and B to yield a matrix C. The output matrix C can be partitioned into four tasks as given below. Now you can see in this slide the matrix of size n by n. A is the input matrix, B is the input matrix, they are multiplied and we get a resultant matrix C. Okay. Now everybody knows the natural formula for multiplying the matrices. We get the resultant matrix C, where the element of the C are C11, C12, C21. And C22. So now our main intention is output data decomposition. So you can select the output data resultant matrix C and decompose that. Now you can see here how I can decompose it. So I can decompose it into subtasks. So I got task 1, task 2, task 3, task 4. Okay, decomposition, you know. So either it is a fine grained decomposition or a coarse grained decomposition. Okay, think on this. This is a fine grain or coarse grain. What do you mean by fine grain decomposition? Let me remember you, or let me revise that section. Fine grain decomposition is decomposing the task into or problem into large number of small tasks. That is a fine grain decomposition. So if I decompose the problem into large number of small size, okay, then that is a fine grain. And opposite to that, there is a coarse grain. Small number of large tasks. So what is this? This is a coarse grain decomposition where I just find out only four tasks. Okay. So that is a coarse grain decomposition. So how I find out the task number one? C11 is equal to A11 into B11 plus A12 into B21. So the matrix multiplication formula, we know the A11, that means the first element of first matrix is multiplied with first element of second matrix plus the second element, that is a first row second element of first matrix is multiplied with for second element of first column of second matrix. So that is a natural formula or general formula of matrix multiplication. But by using this formula, we get our first task, that is C11 is equal to A11 into B11 plus A12 into B21. Similarly, now you can see the C12, how I can get the C12. So same thing, A11 into B12 Now we select here second element plus A12 into B22, that is a second resultant element of the matrix C. Similarly, we find out task 3 and task 4, that is a output data decomposition. Okay, everybody clear with this? So here the output data decomposition is nothing but we select the output data, here the resultant matrix C is selected, and the four elements of this matrix C11, C12, C21 and C22, so further they are selected for decomposition. Okay, that is the output data decomposition. Second slide will clear to you that output data decomposition, partitioning the output data does not result in unique decomposition into task. For example, for the same problem as given in the previous example, with identical output distribution, we can derive the following two or other decomposition. So it is not necessary that all the decomposition are of same type. So the different student or you can find out the different ways of decomposition. Like here it is shown, same problem, whatever we have seen in the previous slide, same problem is decomposed into two different ways, decomposition 1 and decomposition 2. You can clearly observe this, how the decomposition 1 is carried out. See, task 1 is equal to C11 is equal to A11 into B11. Okay, now what we are doing in task 2, C11 equal to C11 plus A12 into B21, because we need to add whatever the result of this A11 and B11 is, need to add with A12 and B21. Then we can, the general fundamental rule of matrix multiplication we cannot violate. We need to stick up ourselves with that fundamental rule of matrix multiplication, but only change or only we can modify the way of decomposition. Okay, so that's why this slide shows you there are different ways or different creativities you can employ for decomposition of output data. Okay, now take one example of you can say it is consider the problem of counting the instance of given atom set in database of transaction. Now this is the database of a grocery shop or a big mall in which different atoms are there, and at the end of the day the owner of that grocery shop or the mall need to identify how many transactions take place on the different atoms, how many atoms are sale, how many atoms are remain, and all the transactions need to be checked at the end of the day. So for this reason, see what is done here, the transaction, that is a number of transactions are nothing but the input, and the atom set is also the input, but the frequency of accessing the atom set is the output in this example. Okay, in this example the frequency of the atom set is the output. Now how I want to select the output data for decomposition. So I select the atom set frequency for decomposition. Okay, so you can see in the slide number in the below figure, task 1 and task 2 are created after this decomposition. So frequency of atom set is decomposed into 1302, and in the task 2 1200, this atom set frequency is selected or considered. Okay, so depending upon that we decompose the output data into two subtasks. Okay, now next, see, for the previous example the following observation can be made: if the database of a transaction is replicated across the processes, each task can be independently accomplished with no communication. So if the database is partitioned across processes as well, for reason of memory utilization, each task first computes partial counts, and these counts are then aggregated at appropriate tasks. Okay, so this is a output data decomposition. where two examples are shown for your understanding. First one is a matrix multiplication, and the resultant matrix C is selected for decomposition, and we got this kind of different decomposition methods or creativities, and 8 different tasks are found out for this output data decomposition for matrix multiplication. Second example, we have seen this database of transactions where the frequency of atom set is selected for decomposition, and we get these two different subtasks after decomposing that database for frequency of transactions. So I hope that you'll understand what is meant by decomposition and what is your first method, data decomposition, under which also we have selected the output data for decomposition. In the next video, we will select or we will focus on input data decomposition and intermediate data decomposition as a part of data decomposition techniques. Okay, till then, thank you very much. Goodbye.